What is my expectation of being baptized in the Holy Ghost? Let's just start there. What is my expectation of being baptized in the Holy Ghost? What should I think that's going to look like? And I'm not going to be imaginative, because if I'm imaginative, who knows what I'm going to come up with? Maybe it's running down the street with your hair on fire. You know, that's, I'm going to go with specifically what the scripture says. If I'm going to be baptized in the Holy Ghost, I really would like to have a rushing mighty wind, clothed in tongues of fire. I mean, I want to, and I want to be so overwhelmed, because the one thing that you do see there in Acts chapter 2 is you see a great ecstasy going on. And furthermore, you recognize, wait a minute, I understand why I'm receiving this in the first place. It's to have power to do the same works of Jesus. And Jesus was always modeling those works. And so there's certainly not going to be any shortage on information with respect to where Jesus wants to take us. I mean, he wants to take us to a place of walking on the water after having multiplied a bunch of, having multiplied a few loaves and a few small fishes, you know, and feeding more than 20,000 people. The very next thing he does is he walks on the water, okay, and then he gets in the boat, and immediately the boat's to shore. So he feeds the multitudes, walks on the water, and gets translates a whole group of people. Okay, so this is where we're going. Okay, everybody got that?
Yeah.
Now we know where we're going. Okay, so, and if we're going somewhere less, then reality of it is, it's non-biblical. Yeah. It's just simply non-biblical.
Yeah.
I mean, if this isn't going to take me to the place of what Christ Jesus described for me to do, hello, listen to me, don't get distracted, look at me. I'm over here, I'm not over there. Look at me. Because you want to get your full attention in on God. You want to get your full attention on the Holy Spirit. You want to say, I want to move with you, Holy Spirit. I want to do the things that you're doing. So why would we be non-biblical? Why we're all trying to be biblical? Why would we be non-biblical when we really, truly, sincerely want to obey what God has said and has willed for our lives? Why do we want to be satisfied with the way that we, I mean, take a picture of me. Take a picture of me. I'm not going to look like I look next year. I looked at a picture last year. I would like to look like actually I did last year. But I'm changing. I'm growing older. I'm maturing. I better be growing older and maturing in the Spirit. And I better be growing older and maturing in the Spirit faster than I'm growing older and maturing in the body. Otherwise, I'm not on the right growth scale, because we're going to get nowhere with the gospel here.
Yeah.
We're going to get nowhere with the gospel here. This is supposed to be the expedited. This is the expedited plan. You know, I spent a lot of time studying Jesus training the disciples. I'm focused on that, looking at that, looking and being a disciple, of understanding how he trained the disciples and what he expected of them. And then I hear him tell me, I'm going to give you an expedited plan. Well, an expedited plan for what you did with them. Look at how quickly they developed. Look at all the stuff they went through in 3 years. Look at what went on in their life. They cast out devils. They raised the dead. The blind eyes were open. The deaf ears were unstopped. And what happens is we get stuck in a world and a culture and a religious system that we have validated for ourselves to be right. And it's completely non-biblical. It's completely non-biblical. But if you try to tell somebody, they just look at it like, help me, Pastor. Well, I'm trying to help you, but you got to unplug whatever's stopping your hearing up spiritually, huh? And begin to hearken unto the voice of the Lord. And the first thing that's going to happen is there's going to be a desire. There's going to be a passion on this side of you. I'm going to be different.
Yeah.
I am going to be like God designed me to be. Hallelujah. I'm not going to let anybody impose upon me, especially myself, because I'm going to tell you right now, you're the worst tyrant to you.
Yeah.
I promise you, you imposing things on yourself, that give me a break. You know, here's the disciples, okay? It's you know, they've just had this amazing thing that they still don't even know what happened. They've just been, Jesus just handed them a small piece of bread and a small piece of fish, and something happened. They ended up with that feeding over 20,000 people. They're still just reeling from the miracle, watching all that went down in that. I mean, the surprises, the power of God, the anointing, the effect of it. It was a revival meeting beyond anything that you've ever been in. If you've ever been in a Holy Ghost revival meeting, it was so much bigger than that and so much more than that. And now it's Jesus' success has brought him to a place that by and large, everybody now wants to force upon him a promotion that they want to give him, namely make him king. And he's not going to submit himself to that promotion. He's going to go and retreat into a place of prayer and consecration to the Lord. And he's going to send his disciples now across the sea, across the lake, forgive me. And when they take off going across this lake, you can imagine where they're at. They're just like, did you see what happened? It was amazing. How many people do you reckon you fed? I know I fed at least 3,000 people, and just the bread just keep coming out. I think it was getting bigger. And you know, Thomas says, no, my piece wasn't getting bigger. Just every time I broke it off, it was the same. It had no diminish. It never diminished. It didn't diminish. It was just like the woman's barrel of flour and like the cruse of oil. I poured it out, but it was still the same of what it was before I poured it out. It didn't fill all the way up. It just never diminished. It was only one more scoop in there, but there was always one more scoop. It didn't matter how many times I pulled it out, it was always one more scoop. I could sit there, I could fill up barrels full of one more scoop. The one more scoop, it never left. I mean, it sets the expectation of what we're going to do. I've seen people who go with the expectation of what God described in His Word, and then they take that and they recognize, wait, He's the same God today as He was then. And so now they need to see one can of soup feed 100 people, and so they poured into a pot, and one can of soup feeds 100 people. Elisha did it, 1 Kings chapter 4, we talked about it the other night. Once, I heard about one ministry where, and it was a huge number of people, a huge gathering of leaders. I believe it was like several thousand people. It was huge number of people. And there was one big, huge pot, and The Lord instructed, they prayed over the pot, multiply the food, and the Lord instructed them, do not look in the pot. And this was a convention that lasted over a week.
Wow.
And so every day, it fed out of the one pot. They have fed people. One day it was beef, the next day it was chicken. They just went through the whole line of it. Don't look in the pot was the instruction from the Lord. Where did they get that? Where was the goal? How did they know to get there? Because I read it in the Word, and this is what my expectation is based on, because this is what the Word of God said. This is what I'm going to do. This is what I'm supposed to do. And it was already, it didn't begin that day. It began in their walk, in their relationship with the Lord from day one. It wasn't just speaking out in the air, just doing things as an expenditure of energy and saying that is a means to an end in of itself. That you know, I'm just going to go ahead and give myself to the language of the Spirit, and then that's just going to be good enough.
No.
And as a means to an end of itself, that's not what it's about. That's not what it's about. You know, God demands that it excel, and that it excel to the expression that where that I pray in the Spirit, I pray with the understanding also. Hallelujah. I sing in the Spirit, I sing with the understanding also. I want to do both. Some people just sing in the Spirit, but they never sing with the understanding. Some people just sing in the understanding, they never sing with the Spirit. They live a non-biblical life. They want to pray in the understanding, but they don't want to pray with the Spirit. They pray with the Spirit, don't want to pray with the understanding. It's non-biblical. It's a non-biblical life.
Yeah.
It's non-biblical. You're not going after what's available for you. To finish the story, finally, the woman who was the overseer's wife looked into the pot, and it was empty. There was nothing there. Every day, she was pulling out of a pot. You talk about a great work. There wasn't even a scoop of flour. There wasn't, you know, in the cruse of oil, you know, still a quart of oil, you know, or a cup of oil. There was nothing even there. She was the ladle. Today it's roast beef, and it fed 1,000 people plus. Today it's chicken, and it fed 1,000 people. But it was the basis of moving in the Spirit and moving in divine expectation. I'll give you it once again. I want to go back to here. They are now obeying the Lord Jesus Christ by divine instruction in a divine commission to go to a destination. And obedience, here they are. They're just, and now that it's they started in the evening, and now it's the fourth watch, which means it's somewhere between 3 in the morning and 6 in the morning. It's all night. After a while, you're at the point of exhaustion. And now the wave and the wind's so intense and it's threatening you and you're at the point of exhaustion. You way off course because the wind has blown you off course, because that's what happens. Anybody that knows the sea, these are veteran fishermen. And yet what's going to go on in their life is they're going to be faithful. Oh, they're blessed their heart. They're faithful. Bless their heart. They're not turning around. They could have been instantly back to shore. They're just like a bunch of church people. They're going to be faithfully there. They didn't really feel like coming. They're not going to cooperate with what the preacher says because they don't really even believe it. I'm going to get to the story. I'm with the story. I'm still in the story. I'm still in it.
Yeah.
But they're going to be faithful. Bless God, we're going to go there. He told us to go there. Hmm? They had already learned a lesson. Jesus said, if you were in readers in Matthew, it would be Matthew chapter 14. Matthew chapter 8, they already learned a lesson. Jesus spoke to the wind and the wave and said, peace, be still, stop. And looked at them and said, why didn't you do it? Now here they are. They've just been in an amazing miracle meeting. They've just been, it's just been proven to them that they have been entrusted with divine power. I mean, after you have basically broken off a piece of bread and a piece of fish to 1,000 people and it wasn't enough to feed you and they're all full, so that means you broke it off to them over and over and over again, and there was so much left over that 12 basketfuls were taken up. You should feel like you got some anointing. You should feel like you got some divine authority happening in your life. You know, I know what it's like to move with the anointing. You vibrate with it, you know, like for 2 days. You're just under this realm of divine power. Huh? What would it be like? I mean, it would be like 5 cups of mate, 20 cups of coffee, 6 Red Bulls and, 4 or 5 hour energies. And then the anointing gives it to you. Just like, poof. I mean, you look at Elijah. What the anointed did, he outran the chariot of Ahab, the fastest horse in the land. I mean, you know. And then he takes off and runs for 40 days. What a sprint. You talk about a marathon. Give me a break. Wow. It does. It energizes you. And they're like, for 8-9 hours. But now they're like, we're going to die. Now their life is in peril. It's threatened. All they do is they rely upon they're confined in prison to the human frame of reference, to the natural thinking, to the arm of flesh. And they never move beyond that which the goal had already been placed before them. The model had already been given them. And we got to think about this. This is the word. This alone separates out whether you live a non-biblical life and your love for Jesus or a biblical one. I got a bunch of people. Oh, I just love Jesus. And they're not biblical at all. And we'll point the fingers at the ones that we can really tell, well, they're not biblical. They don't go to church on Sunday. Well, you know what? Most of what people do, they show up for church on Sunday, are not biblical. You know, did you notice that the Lord told, he said, for the church to go into all the world, we think that all the world's supposed to come to the church. We don't get it. Hello, we don't get it. Okay, are you with me?
Yes.
Have I offended anybody yet?
No.
Okay, good. The reality of it is, we've got to get our feelings off our sleeves so somebody can give us some instruction that tells us what to do instead of always feeling like we're getting beat up.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, it's okay for you to feel that way up until the time that you're like 16. If you're a guy, you can go like 18 if you're a girl. Okay? But you're going to have to get over that, man. You're going to have to grow up and quit like, you know, my mom, he was like, pardon me for living. You know, I should have said nothing. You know, people say, what can I not do to offend you today? I mean, it's just that is the status quo. And God's people are supposed to be these people that are just so earnest and so sharp, and they're sitting up on the edge of their seat, you know, in the sprinter's position, right? Are you with me? You're up on the edge of your seat because you're wanting to take the instruction because you want to get this. You want to do this. You know where you're going. You know what your goals are. You know what the purpose is. I mean, I'm empowered with the Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit has come to me on this level. And he's come to me on this level, and it's not some unique category. This is for everybody who's willing. This is for everybody. First and foremost is you've got to be born again to be a candidate for what God wants to do in terms of empowering us with this wonderful gift of the Holy Ghost. It is available in the sense that it's poured out, the Holy Spirit is poured out upon all flesh, anyone who's willing. As much as His blood was given and shed for the sins of the whole world, as many as are willing, as many as will participate. In the school of the Spirit, we have not really understood how to properly participate. Next, I'm going to do a school of Spirit next Friday night. Next Friday night, what I'm going to do, because I want to break some of these things down for you. You know, I want to show you how that I'll take a verse of Scripture or I'll take a subject in the Bible and how that I'll let the Holy Ghost break it out for me. And how that, you know, and I'm not going to be able to fully do it because when I sit down to do it, I'm going to be there for hours. I'll be there for hours. And I won't just let this go off in my thinking realm. Because if I do, the dots are never going to be connected. Have you ever noticed that you never really know or understand something until you actually write it out? You don't. It's just fragments of information. And then after you write it out, you're editing, and then you edit it again, and you edit it again, and you go, wow, I can't even believe I wrote that. Let me just scratch that one out. Huh? That's a little bit off. Hello. You go check in, looking at verses of Scripture, because now you're going to prove every point. And I want to show you how to do that, because you write something out. Like, people love to be creative, but a lot of people don't like to work. I'll say that again. People love to be creative, but a lot of folks don't like to work. Okay, you can be all creative all you want to, but the work is about to begin. Because now you've got to get yourself a bunch of verses of Scripture to prove every point that you just made. And you can't be spinning it like Fox News. Selah. You know, it's got to be exactly what God said, the way He said it. You can't be making something different out of it. It's got to be in the proper context. And if you don't do this, what's going to happen is you're never going to know what's available to you. And even then, you're not going to get it unless the Holy Spirit makes it real to you. And suddenly you have this moment, you go, you have this moment of discovery, this moment of revelation. Wow, I can do this. He said to do this, and then showed us how to do it, and then reminded us in showing us how to do it, how that a prophet of old, or two, or three, or four, or five, also did it, and He's actually telling you and me to do it too. So first thing is, I got to get over the way I feel about myself, because I don't feel like I can do much of anything, or I feel like I'm better than anybody else. It can extreme, it's extremes. Some people don't feel like they can do anything, some people feel like they can do everything. It's just like, you know, the extremes, the quandary of humanity. Some people feel like they got to do everything. Some people feel like they don't need to do nothing. Both extremes. It's just extremes. It's just like you gotta push all that stuff off your table, erase your chalkboard in Jesus' mighty name. Oh, I wish I could crawl up in your head right now and erase your chalkboard. And write upon your life the Word of God that says this is who you are. And then you'd sit up in your seat and you'd go, wow. That's what the Holy Ghost is supposed to be doing over here. Somebody's going to have to leave Him alone, let Him get His work done. Somebody's going to have to quit running some interference. Somebody's going to have to say, wait a minute, I'm going to agree with you, God, and I'm going to go where you're trying to take me. I'm going to learn how to speak it like, could you just imagine somebody just like raise their hand in the back of the boat, hey guys, remember what happened last month? You know, I don't know about you, and I'm totally worn out. I mean, and just think about where we've just been. And just think about who's commissioned us to go. You know, because Jesus is going to lay it out in Mark chapter 6. He's going to say, they were all whammy. They were beside themselves. They were speechless because the hearts were still not able to accept, harden, still not able to accept what just happened with the loaves and the fishes. Because they're like, you know, Jesus gets in the boat after Peter's walking on the water with him. After he's walking on the water, now Peter's walking on the water with him. Now this thing is getting completely out of control. It's like every law of the universe that they knew anything about has been broken, has been violated. Are they on earth? Are they in heaven? Where are we at? Somebody pinch me. Am I awake or asleep? Is this even taking place? Are you with me? Because that's where you and I are at right now. That's where you and I are at right now. The only thing that's going to push you out of where you're at, that limitation, is where you begin to obey God and start speaking His Word and doing it with Him. Yeah. Yeah. The heart just couldn't even get it, because now all of a sudden he steps in a boat and immediately they're on dry land. They spent 8 hours. They've gotten halfway across the lake. The lake's about, you know, right about 8 miles wide. They've gotten about halfway across, about 4 miles. He gets in the boat. Poof. As soon as he steps in the boat, they're sitting on the shore. Come on now. I mean, people just act like that this is some kind of story told. Put yourself there. Just put yourself there for a minute. Every law in the universe has been violated. You've walked on the water. Peter's walked on the water. We've just been translated, the whole boat, everybody. Through over 4 miles. We're sitting here on the shore. What has happened? And the Lord's just developing an expectation for the miraculous. And says he's got an expedited program. She said, there's nothing. I'm getting ready to give you the expedited program here in just a couple years. Think about it. Think about it. Well, actually, by this time, because this is the second Passover, I'm going to give you the expedited program next year. And that's our response. And it really was, in part and large, their response. And so it's the earnestness of Paul saying, I'm praying continually that you get the spirit of wisdom and revelation as you get some knowledge, the knowledge of the Lord. You understand what's going on here, the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. You're missing it that you've been given a heavenly life, because all Jesus was doing and all Peter was doing was just showing us that by the word of faith, you can step out, you can master all the physical realm, you can master that which is defeating you, that which kept you from walking in your divine purpose. You can step on, you can tread upon it. You can tread upon it. That which had subdued you, now you have subdued.
Yeah.
Think about it. The word of faith comes, and now you begin to walk in the Spirit. And that's what it looks like. Word of faith comes, bid me come to you. Word of faith comes, I'll walk on the water too. That's walking in the Spirit. It's a supernatural walk. But yet we've made it something that it's not. Well, I got it. I got up and I read my 5 verses in the Bible this morning. I don't understand what you're talking about. And I labored through a whole 15 minutes of prayer. I still don't get it. Or you tell me you prayed for an hour. You passionately got after it, touched heaven, prayed for an hour. I still don't get it. What more do you want? Well, what you just did meant nothing by asking that question. Because what ultimately, that place where you touch the Word of God, which is Spirit and life, it brings you to this. It brings you into a cooperation with another realm that's there that Jesus is showing. He's showing another realm. He's like, are we in heaven or are we in earth? That's what they're asking. Where on earth are? Where are we? Can you even do this? What is happening? We've just watched 20,000 people fed with, you know, a few loaves of barley and 2 small fish. Give me a break. Now we're walking on the water. Now we're being translated. I mean, come on. The everything about your life and your understanding has been interrupted with a revelation and encounter with heaven. We just stuck in this realms of the earthly encounter, earthly thinking, and we don't want to change because we didn't set the right goal. We didn't set the right goal. We made it some other thing than it truly is. The Lord has empowered us to be witnesses of heaven, to show forth His glory, to move in His divine power and authority. And if I'm like coming to the meeting and somebody's basically telling me, listen, you know, the Lord wants to baptize you in the Holy Ghost. And all I believe that baptism in the Holy Ghost is going to be is about, you know, speaking this language. And all I'm going to do is just speak this language. And I don't understand that it's this great intimacy of relationship with the Holy Spirit that just went to another level, so that I'm in now in a connection with Him to be able to learn how to function in the power and the authority of Jesus Christ on an expedited scale. That I see the disciples, that I'm all messed up. I'm all messed up. I'm non-biblical. I'm taking something that is sacred and wonderful and glorious, and I'm misapplying it to something that is absolutely, completely out of context. I'm praying in the Holy Ghost to open up blind eyes. I'm praying in the Holy Ghost. I'm praying in the Holy Ghost to be able to prophesy. I'm praying in the Holy Ghost to be able to speak by the word of knowledge. I'm praying in the Holy Ghost to speak by discernment. I'm praying in the Holy Ghost to step over into a whole other display of the power and the glory of God, both in character and dimension, in His demeanor, the dimensions of His demeanor and the dimensions of His power, unlimited power. Because that's what Jesus is saying. I mean, I'm still right there on what the Lord was saying on Wednesday night. And he's pleading with God's people. He's pleading with his people to do it. Listen, the Holy Spirit has come to take everything that belongs to the Father and transmit it to you and me. And that's got a demand of us, a goal. What does that look like? What am I going to be doing with that? Hallelujah. If you're not involved in ministry, we need you in ministry right now. I've got to try to move some people around because we don't have enough ministry. We don't have enough people right now in ministry to be to really effectively do what we're attempting to do and making the gateway into the church being ages 13 to 17. We don't have enough folks. We got to have more people. You know, I was talking to the leaders today, just saying just before I came into this meeting, I said, you know, there's four categories of people. There's people who are deciding to be followers. There's followers, and some people never stop being a follower because it's just always, they never want to make the transition. They're just, praise God, they're followers, but they never get it. They never get it. They never do it. That means you never. And then there's people who are training to be leaders. Does the Lord ever give up on followers? No, He doesn't. He doesn't. Even if it's like, you know, he never gets, you know, the Word of God, the context of the Word of God isn't reach him. The context of the Word of God isn't teach him. The context of the Word of God isn't send him. The context of the Word of God is reach him, teach him, send him. That's what God says to do. Now, we want to be non-biblical about it. Oh, well, you're the reachers, you're the evangelists, okay? You're the teachers, you're the pastors, you're the senders, so therefore you're the apostles. So you guys do the reaching, you guys do the teaching, you guys do the sending. It's just, can God use that? Will He use that? Sure. But that's not the context. That's not biblical context. And you decide whether or not you're going to fully cooperate with God and whether or not you're in that program yourself. Are you in the program? Have you set biblical principles for your life? I got people telling me all the time about their biblical principles. And I'm like, well, can I see you live a couple of them, please? Pretty please, a couple of them. In the biblical principles that we recognize that the Lord says he's called us to come in the fullness of the measure, the maturity of the ministry of Jesus. Where is that principle to where that you are so applying to the things of the kingdom that you're pressing into that? Where is the reality where you have connected with, wait a minute, me, I am being trained. I was reached, I'm being trained to be sent. Where is that, the mentality of where how you're participating with God, of how you're taking your notes, of how you're interacting? Because a lot of people just think we're babysitting them. They think that we're throwing the ball up and now it's going to be who catches the ball, run with it because we're going to tackle you. Who's ever got the ball is going to get tackled. And it becomes this ploy of, well, I agree or I disagree, or, you know, he's accommodating me, or he's picking on me, or he likes me or he dislikes me. And it's all the division and all the strife and all the issues about whether or not we really are making you happy. It's like one guy said, if you want to make people happy, sell ice cream. The last thing you want to do is go in the ministry because everybody dislikes you immediately. And especially the religious. The only people that are going to really appreciate what you have to say are the non-religious, because they're interested in, what is that about Jesus? What is that about life? What is that you're saying? Religious people, oh, they just want to argue. Well, I don't believe that. I don't believe that. And I'm verse scripture and that verse scripture. And you say this about me and I'm not that way. It goes on and on. It's just a crazy thing. And the Lord is just going, behold, I and the people which the Lord has given unto me. And I want that to change. Don't you want that to change? I don't want the Lord to have to hang out with a bunch of people that are living non-biblical lives, trying to say that, you know, that they really fit into the mold when they're not even in the casting. You know, it's like, wait a minute. I have to see myself in the Word. I have to see myself as being a participant with every dimension of this wonderful divine plan that was rolled out by the Son of Man, Almighty God manifested in flesh, the Son of the living God, Christ Jesus. Amen. I'm not going to just sit around here and be religious.
Right.
Once again, you're not going to get to heaven and stand before the throne of grace and the Lord give you a pop quiz on how many verses of scripture you know. It's all about what you live, the word that you lived.
Amen.
And then when I stop and I say, wait a minute, I'm a living scroll. I'm a living epistle written by God. Well, does my life, my conduct, my character, my goal setting, my demeanor, the things I'm going after that I'm passionate about, does it look like what's written in the scripture? Does it look like opening up blind eyes, deaf ears, crippled walking, walking on the water, commanding the wind and the wave, being translated, representing heaven, walking as co-inheritors with Christ Jesus in the fullness of God, heirs of God, all these things that God says is wonderful, impossible things that God says. Yeah. These things that go beyond all. And if I'm relying on the arm of flesh, how far have we gone? Actually, I think we lost ground. And we were, and before we're on course, I think we've been blown off like about 4 miles. We've not only not even gone a mile, we're now off course 4 miles, so now we're actually total about 7 miles further than we were. The arm of flesh, obedient to the master's voice. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Oh God. When are you going to come and help us? And you know they were lifting up their voice. Oh, Lord! Psalms 107. There, you can hear. Oh, God, we're crying unto you. Hear us in a time acceptable, oh, God. Jesus turning, seeing them in the spirit. Huh? And the situation they were in. Came walking to them on the water. They're like, praise God. No, they're like, it's a ghost! Ah! You know, the faith level, it's just really not there. It's just really not there. And I love getting in these stories because it encourages me. I'm thinking, Jesus, this is what you got. This is your ministry at work. Thank you for the encouragement. Because it's a divine event that must take place. A divine event must take place in people's lives. There's a sorting out of those who want to obey and be followers and those who just want to hang out and do whatever it is that they're doing and live their own life and say that they're a part of the crowd. But my goodness, the responsibility that's on our shoulders to be living epistles written of God and read of men and understand that that is decided by the Father and designed and displayed in Christ Jesus. And it can't be any other. Otherwise, it's non-biblical. It's non-biblical. It's non-biblical. Why participate in things that have nothing to do with the plan of God when all the time, all we had to do was turn unto Him, yeah, repent and obey Him, yeah, and we would step into the grandiose plan of the Father and begin to move in this wonderful realm of the supernatural, yeah, and no longer tire depending upon the arm of flesh, getting actually nowhere and worse than that, further off course with every passing minute. Good. Thanks you, Lord Jesus, for praying. He's still in the mountain praying. He was in the mountain and went apart to pray. He's still interceding. He's up in the highest mountain of all now, the highest place of all, the holies of holies, interceding and praying. And He sees us when we begin to put all of our heart and all of our passion and everything that we have into obeying Him and doing it His way and walking out His vision and walking out His instruction. Because I'm going to tell you right now, that which He displayed for them that night wasn't on display for the rest of the world. Nobody else got to see this. This belonged only to the inner circle, only to those who had forsaken all, who had left everything, who had placed their lives in jeopardy, in peril, who had counted their lives as nothing to follow this one that they don't even have a clue who He really is, this man from Galilee. They're just stuck on the miracles which He did. It's true. Their hearts are captivated. So much so that they left their job, they left their home, they left their family. Think about it. Think about it. There wasn't a lot of people that would do that then, and there's not a lot of people that would do that now. They left their home, their job, their family with total abandonment. They just took off. They just didn't show up to work the next morning. They went in, they packed their stuff and said, honey, I don't know how long I'm going to be gone. but I'm following the Master. And the same crisis, the same issues, the same arguments, the same, what on earth are you doing now? How could you possibly imagine that this is God? It's true. It's true. It's true. And then they're gonna, and on top of that, they're gonna get the next service they're gonna go to, Jesus is really gonna cut loose. He's gonna cut loose so hard and so radical and so intense. He's gonna tell people they didn't come because they want the truth. They just come because they want, they're concerned about their belly. They just want to get fed. They're just looking for a free meal. And then he's gonna tell them, he's gonna sort them out. He's going to tell him, eat my flesh and drink my blood. Eat my flesh and drink my blood. And then they're going to have all their scriptures going off. And all the way they, whether that was the love of God, he wouldn't be saying it like that. And he'd explain himself more. And he wouldn't speak in such abstract parables. And then the guys that have just multiplied loaves and fishes are going to start leaving. Not the ones that were in the boat. The ones who were in the boat stayed. Phew. The ones that were in the boat stayed. But many of the disciples, there were other disciples there besides just the 12. He sent a boatload of disciples. A boatload of disciples. We know at least 12 of them stayed. And as far as we know, there was somewhere between, there was probably more than 12 that stayed that day. Because it won't be long. And the, you know, well, let me just put it this way. We know, let's just stay with what we definitely know. 12 stayed. Basically, everybody else left. They couldn't handle the message. The church went from huge, massive following down to 12. And he looked at them after the loaves and the fishes, the miracle of walking on the water, the translation, and said, will you go also? What are you going to do? Are you out of here? Are you staying or are you leaving? One guy speaks out. where can we go? Yeah. Where is it that we can go? It's like, that wasn't a definite yes. And it wasn't a definite no. It was like, we're considering it, but what are the options? I mean, as a leader, you don't feel real good about that reply from the most intimate, the people that you poured out your life to train. You'd like to say, we're going nowhere. We know who you are. We're here with you. Rather than, what are the options? Praise God that for them, all it took was Pentecost. All it took was Pentecost. Pentecost changed everything for them. It changed everything for them. It changed everything. Pentecost should be for us open heaven. Pentecost should be for us an ability to interact with the divine like never before, to enter into the realms of heaven, to live in the realms of relationship and intimacy and power and authority, to know that when we speak, it happens. A faith comes to an all-time high, the explosion of the manifestation of the Spirit of God.
Amen. Yes.
The word of knowledge, the word of wisdom. And if you're not being willing to submit yourself to the church, to learn how to give yourself to the study of the word, to give yourself to prayer, authoritative Holy Ghost prayer, if you're not willing to give yourself to walking, learning how to be taught how to walk in spiritual gifts, how to walk in signs and wonders and miracles, then what? You're non-biblical. You've got a non-biblical life. And unfortunately, I have to tell you, I have to break the news to you, there's not a lot of people who live a biblical life.
True.
Imaginatively, we do. We want to. We say that we want to. We all say yes. We got all these basic approvals. If you say, how many of you want to be leaders? Everybody raises their hand. How many of you want to go to the nations? Everybody raises their hand. How many of you want to follow and function in signs and wonders and miracles? Everybody raises their hand. But there's something else to this than just raising your hand.
Yeah.
It's the press. It's the absolute surrender. It is the giving wholly of yourself over to these things. It's so consumed with them and so consecrated to them because you absolutely are convinced of the certainty of it. Because it wasn't easy for 120 to show up on the day of Pentecost. It wasn't easy. There was more than 500 brethren, and you could say 500 disciples at that time collected together that were there when Jesus, what a miraculous event after the resurrection, and they watch him go up and disappear right at about cloud level. And then they have angels standing and they're saying, "Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus shall return in like manner as you have seen him go." There was about 500 brethren, according to what Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, that was there on that day. Only 120 make it, because it's going to risk your life. It's going to cost you something. It's not going to be convenient. It's going to be hard. You're going to miss out on everything that you were supposed to do. It is not going to make any sense to you. It isn't going to connect the dots. You're going to have somebody explain it to you. And as soon as somebody's got to explain it to you, you're out. You're out. Satan will take you out. You're out. Faith can't work. Your heart's not hungry, because a hungry heart doesn't need explanation. This is what we're going to do. Huh? I don't need an explanation. Even doubting Thomas. We like to say doubting Thomas. He wasn't that much of a doubter, but he always had some kind of a weird notion about the thing. So they're going to go raise Lazarus from the dead, right? Thomas said, "Let us go with him and die with him. Die together with him." Because he knows they're going to kill him over there. And it's just too close to Jerusalem. It's about 2 miles from Jerusalem. And we're going to go to visit Lazarus. They're going to kill us. And Bethany, they're going to kill us. "Let us go that we may die with him." But that's the consecration. It's not like we're not going to sit here and reason about it. We're going to have to have explanations. Get in the boat, go to the other side. But a storm's coming up. And what's going to happen? I'm going to tell you right now what's going to happen. I've been doing this all of my life. You know how old I am. And I tell you right now, there's Andrew's here, Peter, James, speak up. John, what's going to happen is we're going to get out here on this water, and it ain't going to be 10 minutes. And we're going to be faced with a violent storm. And I promise you, we will not be there by tomorrow. We will not be there. There's no way. We understand this. We understand this lake. I've lived on it. My father, my grandfather, my great-grandfather, I was taught by the time I'm 10 years old not to go out in this kind of weather. That didn't happen. They got in the boat and they went. I don't argue about it. I don't try to figure it out. Well, how does that work? How does it that I'm going to pray in the Spirit and then pray and understand? I just believe it. I just follow him. I just go with him. This is just what is going to happen. I just do it. I just do it. I just do it. Because I'm not self-conscious anymore. It's not all about me. What people are going to think about me and preserving my life. We come from a history of people who go and are burned at the stake and are drowned and are cut in two and are thrown to lions and stoned by elephants. That's who we are. We don't ask questions and ask whether or not it's convenient, whether or not it's going to work out on our behalf. It's like, I'm totally in. It doesn't even matter. Let everybody stone me. I'm going to prophesy. I'm going to speak in tongues and interpret the tongues. I'm going to flow in the Holy Ghost. I'm totally in. It's a consecrated life. That's what Father's looking for, and that's what he responds to. And that ought to be the goal of our life, the disposition of our heart. That's biblical. That's biblical. That's the biblical. The moment that the church is in great need and great desperation and very peril for their life and they're crying out to God with one heart, he comes supernaturally walking on the water. It will always be that way. It's always been that way, shown to be that way from that very night. It is recorded in Matthew 14, Mark 6, and John 6. And it will continue to be that way even to the coming of the Lord. I see the very day that the Lord comes with the voice of an archangel and the sound of a trumpet, the church in such peril, at the risk of their own life. They're about to die. They're in jeopardy. They cannot go on. And with one voice, they've lifted up their voice to heaven. Oh God, come and deliver us now. Oh God, come now. He will always supernaturally come and take his people to a whole nother level of revelation and faith and expectation. Yeah. You and I have to be all in.
Yeah.
You don't tell me you got to go to work. Listen, I went to work. God had me go to work every day for many, many years, and I was all in. I preached every night. I gave myself to the study of the Word, to touching heaven in prayer, upon my knees, crying out to God, give me a break. I love this. People don't talk about how busy they are. No, you chosen to give yourself to a non-biblical lifestyle, to give yourself to earthly interests and worldly things. Yeah. And then you want to act like you haven't done anything wrong. So you're like Adam, who covered your transgression, and you should not prosper. So it's time, and people just like, say, oh God, let the floodlight of heaven shine upon my soul. I've spent my life for my own pleasure. I've spent my life for what's convenient for me. I've spent my life doing whatever it is that makes me happy. If it's on my time scale, if it's on my terms, then I'll do it for you, Lord. I'm giving you Sunday morning from this time to that time. I'm giving you Sunday night from this time to that time. I'm going to give you Wednesday night from this time to that time. I'm going to give you maybe another night out of the week from this time to that time. And oh, look at all that I'm doing for you. It's nonsense. It is a consecrated, surrendered life. I was crucified with Christ. I no longer live. I'm living a biblical life. I'm not carrying on with my own existence. My existence is about reaching the lost, training God's people, reaching them, teaching them, and sending them. And a lot of people get stuck as followers. They never want to be leaders because leaders have become motivated. They become motivated, become people who you just got to rein them in because they're just going so hard. You got to say, look, you got to slow down. You got to burn out. You got to remember that you're still in your human body. That's leaders. Most people are stuck in followers. They're just following. They're never stepping out to go and do what Jesus said to go and do with the authority that he gave us to do it. And I pray in the name of Jesus tonight that you wrap your heart around Pentecost. And you realize that it's one of the great things, one of the great, wonderful things. You know, the Lord gave us the two best things that he had. Father gave us two best things he had. He gave us Jesus, his only begotten Son, the eternal Word. Who poured out his life unto death for us, and through his blood he loosed us from our sins, and he purified us from every nation, kindred, and tongue. Hallelujah. Who through his resurrection we also received resurrection life, that we might now live this life in him, to not be limited to an earthly realm, but to be seated with him in a heavenly, to sit down with him in this realms of glory now.
Yeah.
And then, having ascended up on high, Father, in response to the works of Christ Jesus, poured out the most sacred thing of all to him, and that is the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost that was not yet given. Huh? He breathed on them. And he said, receive the Holy Ghost. And listen to what he said. Whose ever sins you retain, they shall be retained. Yeah. What authority? What? Yeah. Yeah. He gives them, this is the commission. This is the great commission of John. Receive ye the Holy Ghost. Whose ever sins you retain, they shall be retained. Huh? Whose ever sins you forgive, they shall be released. Yeah. Whoa! Wow.
Yeah.
But the Holy Ghost was not yet given. It was a preparation. It was a breathing into them, a life-given authority for them to live in a whole other dimension of ruling and reigning right now with Christ Jesus in this life. And we want to say that we got that, and we're living a non-biblical existence because we have non-biblical goals, because we don't understand the end of the thing. We don't understand the whole process. We've never set our heart to be what God told us to be. Many of God's people, you're watching me by the web right now, or YouTube, or the Facebook. You never took a nation. You've never let God birth a nation in you. You've never let God birth a burden for your neighbor, for the person that you walk past. You've never understood how to lay hold of God for divine strategies to be able to grab a hold of people that you reach so that they'll stay and they'll be able to be taught. But then you never recognize somehow that the only way that you're going to be able to keep them after that you reach them is that you've got to lay your life down for them.
Amen.
And it's 24 hours a day. And it's not a lot, you know, it's a whole lot more effective. Going out, you know, and ministering to people that you were able to touch with the gospel. You saw some response out of them, but they never reached until they crossed the threshold of the church. And then you've never been enough in the struggles for men's souls to recognize the conflict that's going to happen when they cross the threshold of the church. Satan is going to do everything to offend them. Satan is going to do everything to drive them away. He's going to use every possible means. And I watch over and again where people who are totally aloof, playing with their baby or talking among themselves or letting their kids fight, and right behind them is a someone that God is dealing with, their soul and their eternity is at jeopardy. And people are so aloof, they've never allowed the discerning of the Holy Ghost, the discerning of spirits that are only going to come out of a desire and a passion for the lost. It ain't going to come because you're sitting around doing whatever it is.
Right. Yeah.
It comes because this wonderful gift of the Spirit of the Lord was poured out unto us to be able to go and reach the lost.
Yeah.
And if you don't go out to reach them, and if you don't give, you're never going to have a burden for the lost. You're never going to even understand how to move through, you know, the whole self-consciousness. And men are born with this self-consciousness and this wrong self-image and this desperate need for the approval of other men. There's got to be a translation. There's got to be a transition. There's got to be a transformation.
Yeah.
The miracles of God happen in the acts of obedience.
Yeah.
They don't happen just because you say, okay, yes, I'll do that, but you don't go. You said you would do it, but you didn't go. In other words, you said you would do it, but you didn't do it. That isn't obedience. That isn't obeying the Father. But if we set our goals properly,
yeah.
We say, oh, I know why. I know why I want to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. And, you know, for me, I really want to spend a lot of time with people on this. Listen, the Lord wants to baptize you in the Holy Ghost. I don't pair it up with salvation. Salvation is different. God wants to turn your wellspring into a river every day. He not only want to baptize you in the Holy Ghost once, He wants to continually baptize you. He doesn't want to fill you once. He wants to continually fill you. He wants the Word. He wants His Word to dwell in you richly. He wants in your heart, in your mind, ruling you. He wants to transfer all the things of heaven continually to you. But He can't do that when you're all preoccupied with these other things. And where is your mind and where is your thinking? Is it in doubt and unbelief? Is your heart yet still hardened? Because you've got a bunch of questions instead of just with total abandonment willing to obey the Master. You with me? Tonight, I believe in Jesus' name, these things change for you because the Lord speaks His Word in order to bring forth change. Hallelujah. He works the miracles as He speaks forth the word of faith. Hallelujah. That word of faith goes forth, and if you'll hear and hearken unto that word of faith, immediately great faith is on the inside of you, and you begin to walk out your life in the Holy Ghost. What does it mean to walk out your life in the Holy Ghost? If you define it any different than the way that Jesus lived His life, it is non-biblical. If it is for anything other than what Jesus did, who came as the Lamb of God to lay down His life for a lost and dying world, who was all about reaching the lost, the scattered sheep, going and seeking and saving that which was lost, and doing so with the display of heaven in His life, with the display of God's love, with the authority to be able to say to every tormenting devil, go, to say to every afflicting spirit, go, to say every disease and every sickness, go.
Yeah.
To have that authority in my mouth. Hallelujah. Papa's going to learn, Papa, through the Holy Spirit, the gift of the Holy Ghost, the most sacred gift that He could give us outside of Christ Jesus, is teaching us how to speak that word of faith, how to be boldly walking in that authority, how to ask Him, how to properly ask Him, how to have the insight to move with Him. Listen, if you pray in the Holy Ghost for 15 minutes, you need to pray in the understanding of 15 minutes too. And it's not like you pray for 15 minutes and then pray in the, pray in the Holy Ghost 15 minutes and then pray in understanding 15 minutes. It's just weaved together. And out of that, you begin to learn how, and automatically you begin to flow, and because you're actually touching tongues and interpretation of tongues, just doing that. You're just, oh, but if you're just wide open, all is just tongues, and there's no inspiration to talk to Papa from the Spirit out of the realms of the understanding to speak forth those things that are going to bring change, that have direction, that have insight, then you're stuck. And you'll never move forward. You have wrong goals. You're living a non-biblical life. It's a non-biblical life. People tell me about this thing, that thing. It's And they tell me about how this person hurt them and that person hurt them. I disagree with that and disagree with this. How they can't go to that church or this church. Look, your problem is not with the people. Your problem is not with your husband or your wife or your parents. Your problem is with God. You get that relationship right, and that love will change you into a foot washing slave. And that love will cause you to be that it don't matter what people do to you, you are just expressing love. I have to pull you off of folks and tell them, instead of telling you to go hug them, huh? I had to pull you off of them because you just say, slow down, you got to wait, slow down, slow down. I mean, you're smothering them. I know, but this love of God's got a hold of me. I know, I understand. But you got to be mindful. You have to be mindful. People aren't used to this kind of love. They live in a world of rejection and hate, and it's just too much for them to handle all at once. You got to let them warm up to this. I'd love to be able to pastor from that side of things. I want to. I'm believing God this is going to happen. I'm believing God it's going to happen. Instead of watching people slip out the back door like they got to go to the restroom all of a sudden or something, or make a phone call, give me a break. I know what you're doing. You're not comfortable with love. You're not comfortable with intimacy. You're not comfortable with going to the cross for people. You're not comfortable with laying down. You're not comfortable making other people's lives more important than yours. You live in a shell. Self-contained shell, a non-biblical life. Father wants to get you rid of that. He's so good. He delivered me from my awkward state. He delivered me from my dysfunctional self. He delivered me from my weirdness. Hallelujah. He stepped me over into happy land, place where I'm loving, where I'm walking in His kindness and peace, where I get up in the morning, I got joy on me. I meet people, I don't feel like it's a stranger. I'm not touched by some kind of weird thing that's going on. I'm just overjoyed with the presence of the Lord, and something's flowing out of me that's bigger than anything that's happening in them. That's what the Holy Ghost was given to me for. That's what this new birth is all about. This is a biblical life. I'm just participating with it. It's just such a wonderful, wonderful realm to live in. Such a wonderful realm to live in. Wouldn't you love to not have to ever feel awkward again? Wouldn't you just love to just be overwhelmed with joy and no longer ever influenced by someone's weirdness? Wouldn't you love it? Or their demons or whatever else, you know? You like Professor Gadget in the spirit. You come into a place, the antennas come out, and the radar starts spinning around and around and around. You're picking up on everything, deciding who's got what. No, you give yourself to falling in love with people in the first 5 seconds. Huh? First 5 seconds that you meet him, you fall in love with him the way that God loves him. Yeah. See, because that's the biblical life. Father told us that he had empowered us through the new birth to love just like He loves. And John said, if you can't do it, it's proof that you've not been born again and that you are a liar and that you've gone out from among us and that you're not of company of us, but you're the company that belongs to the deceivers. Shoot, that's what He said. And it's all about love. It's all about loving just like Father loves. Not loving thy neighbor as thyself. Loving like Father loves. Loving like Jesus loves. Come on. Come on. I'm just waiting as a pastor for God's people to get that. Come on. Let me be the recipient. I'm like waiting. I know every pastor in the United States of America are waiting to be recipients of such a conversion. Yeah. So it is true. I heard a Catholic priest get on, I don't know if it's Catholic or Episcopalian, get on CNN the other night, and he said it like it was. He says, we have drifted from a biblical existence into something that has no similarity to anything that God said to us. To His only begotten Son. And I'm sitting there going, wow. And it was on one of those shows that nobody watches because, it's an anti-Trump show. It's that one lawyer, I can't remember his name, but he's always this extreme alt-left. Huh? I think people live in an alt world, an alt reality. Huh? Forget about the alt left and the alt right. That's nothing compared to an alt reality. You with me?
Yes.
You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
And then he's got this guy on there. He's got. I'm like, well, come on, man. This is true stuff. Come on, this is good stuff.
Yeah.
I always like to listen to what everybody's got to say because it's all a bunch of lies. I listen to what the liars say over here and listen to what the liars say over there and go, my goodness gracious, Lord Jesus. Even if you put those lies in the middle, it'd still be a big, gigantic lie. If you got them together to all agree on one thing, it'd be just a gigantic lie. It just allows us, you know, I mean, I'm not even doing it anymore. It's just like, forget about it, you know. I'm just going to pray. It's the opportunity to spend more time in prayer, crying out to God. To step over into those realms of heaven that Father has made available.
Yeah.
If you're not doing what he said to do, you're never going to be in the place to have it.
Right. Yeah.
If you can't get comfortable saying praise God in the midst of a bunch of people in an elevator, you got yourself a problem.
Yeah.
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 Huh?
Yeah.
If you got a problem being around a bunch of folks and just, you know, smoking on their cigars and cussing, you can't say God. The other day I was with a bunch of older guys, rich, wealthy people. They smoking cigars that were a foot in diameter. That's a little bit exaggeration, but they were, I was like, how did you get that thing in your mouth? It's like, it's a wonder. And I said, hasn't the Lord made a beautiful day? And they all said, amen, he has. No, I'm not kidding you. They all got, they like pulled off their hats, you know. Fine. We got to get comfortable, man. We just got to get comfortable being who we are, talking about the goodness of God. Quit trying to bring some kind of story that you don't even live or believe. If you're not living it, you don't believe it. And that's why it's so hard to say. That's why you feel so awkward. That's why it feels like it's bouncing back in your face. That's why people are looking at you kind of strange. One eye's out this way, the other eye's this way. You're with me? Come on, people. My. Father wants us to be able to come minister right to their heart. It ain't going to happen when you're all stressed out and wondering whether or not they're going to like you or whether you're going to say the right thing or the wrong thing or whether. It ain't going to happen. You got to get relaxed. You got to get cozy. You got to get comfortable. You got to get steeled. That's why we were baptized in the Holy Ghost and power. That's why, I just love to think about Peter looking at that transcendent power and glory of Jesus as he's walking on the water. He's going, he's so captivated by heaven, he's going, I got to do that. I got to do that now.
Right.
That's the proper response. I got to do it. He's like, everybody's freaking out, scared to start off with. There's this terrified, they're exhausted. Now they're terrified because a ghost is out there, you know. And they hear the comforting voice of the master sounding out in their ears. Eh?
Yeah.
Can you hear it?
Yes.
Fear not, it's me. It's me, don't be afraid. And they're like immediately comforted. And they're like at the same time captivated and shocked. And can't even believe it, and still trying to catch up with the loaves and the fishes. And, you know, can you imagine? Can you be there? Can you be there? Peter's awake. I got to do that. He remembers what the centurion said, what happened with the centurion. Speak the word only. He hasn't forgot one lesson. He says, speak the word only. Bid me come. He's still faced with the same wind, the same waves, the same turbulence, the same opposing thing that threatened his life, that prevented him from fulfilling what God had commissioned him to do. Now, though, his senses are filled with something different. They're not filled with the waves. They're not filled with the wind. They're not filled with the adversity. They're not filled with the impossibility that he is stuck in, depending upon the arm of flesh. Now his senses are filled with the voice of the master saying, come. His eye, that's all he can hear in his ears, is come to me. All he can see with his eyes is this glory glow of heaven standing there, you know, as the waves. I mean, I don't even know how that worked. I guess I guess Jesus was like on an elevator, go up and down with the waves, you know? Just. Yeah, it's like a boat, right? They just kind of. It had to work that way. Amazing. That's why we were given the Holy Ghost. To have our senses filled with heaven. That's all, the voice of heaven, the sounds of heaven, the glory of heaven, the sight of the miraculous. If that's not our passion, then it's got to become our passion. And then we've got to recognize at the same time, everything that Satan is trying to do to distract us from that and to hide that and to mask that and to make that irrelevant to our life and to cause our senses to rather to be consumed with the opposing things and the earthly things and the worldly things and the things of selfish interest and concern. That's why the Holy Ghost was given insight, revelation. I'll break out into singing. I break out into the praise.
Amen.
I'll break out into the psalm, into the hymn, and the spiritual song. I'm filled with the Spirit. I break out of the psalm, the hymn, the spiritual song, because I'm letting the Word of Christ dwell in me richly. I'm, my senses are being filled with the sound of heaven. Hallelujah. Look around your life. Make sure that everything about your life is absolutely consecrated to the kingdom of God. And there is nothing, absolutely nothing, out of order. Constantly there. I'm constantly there. As a dad, as a protector, as a provider, I'm constantly watching out for my family in the natural, but even more in the spiritual. Okay? You know, I know I'm very comfortable in the woods. I can tell what's moved around. I'm watching. I can see, you know, I know what's been passing by. I know what's going on around me because I can see from the sign, from the tracks, from there's so many different indications in the woods. You know, I'm always making sure that everything's in its right place and everybody's where they're supposed to be. Just so nobody gets hurt and nobody gets injured, especially or lost. But more importantly, dads, you got to do that in the realms of the Spirit. And moms, you got to recognize that Father's given the dads a special anointing to be able to do that. You got to listen up. You got to listen up. I know they're just a stupid guy, but Father has promoted them with a special gifting to be able to have insight and ability to lead and guide in the realms of the Spirit. If they've been born again, especially filled with the Spirit, come on now. We got to have this. Mandolo koshi prevete yatast. To recognize your kids, man, I'm telling you right now, my wife always keep a hawk eye on my kids. They knew it. She knew exactly at all times what they were doing. I knew exactly at all times what they were doing because of my particular vantage point. And if there was one thing out of line, one thing out of order, I'm correcting that thing. I'm getting after it. No. Here's what we're going to do. I didn't mind the kids laying down and going to sleep in the meeting. But they're not going to be passed around, huh? And they're not going to create a disturbance. I told the leaders today, I said, and what I want to do is I want kids to be trained from the time that they're 13 to 17, that they don't create distractions in church. That they learn how to reverence God. Can you imagine? By the time they're 15, they've been trained so many times that they're nudging their parents and saying, listen, you're being irreverent. You're distracting things, and now you're probably going to be the cause of somebody spending eternity in hell. That's God. I'm going to raise up people like that. Yeah. Said folks are just doing whatever they want to do, whatever they feel like doing, whatever I feel like doing. I just live my life for myself anyway. I don't even know anything about what's going on right now in terms of the Holy Ghost dealing with someone's heart, and they're right at the point of decision, and I get up, basically stumble over top of them and completely take them out of it. Because the enemy uses it as a spirit of offense. A rudeness, an interruption. Well, if that's all that means to them, that's what it can mean to me. It just brings them right out. It brings them right out of it. It does. It's true. And it's just simply because people haven't learned the first basics, the very basics of walking in the Spirit. Come on, people. Come on now. Let's go ahead and let's get on the expedited plan. I'm going to say I'm going to bring you a slower plan. It's going to take you a lot longer. I'm going to bring you an expedited plan. It's going to happen a lot faster. It's not going to take you as long as things. These things are going to be, you're going to sharpen up in the realms of the Spirit. And it's going to become about the will of the Father for your life and about the impact on the people around you as to whether or not they're going to see Jesus or be imprisoned by the powers of deception and darkness. And that's what it's all about. And I learned how to be a living epistle written of God and read of men. I learned how to live this thing out by the power of the Holy Ghost. How to say simple things, and it's God's divine arrow of the word of knowledge that finds its target. Simple little things. Simple things. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm really self-conscious because the other night I wore a shirt, the wrong shirt. Every time I raised my hand on television, you could see my belly button. It was crazy. I'm like, Spitzbergen. Those are fundamentals of leadership. I mean, you're supposed to look in the mirror, raise your hand before you ever leave the house and make sure that nothing's showing. So, you know, it is like, I was captivated though. One thing about it is I was raptured. I was raptured. I thought about it every once in a while and I would just do this, you know. But then I get so caught away in God, I forgot about everything. And as I went up high. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, listen, the Lord, He loves us so much. He loves us so much. He loves us so much. I just pray tonight that every one of you will make the decision that you're going to be followers. And that you'll make the decision that you're not going to be indecision about following. You make the decision about following. And you know what that means. And it's defined for you in a biblical manner, not a non-biblical manner. Not on your speculation, what people told you, what you were trained in Sunday school or whatever. But what God said in His Word. If you want to be my disciple, if you want to follow me, you take up your cross, you deny yourself. And understand that in the application of that, in terms of going in obedience to do the things which the Master told us to do. Grab a hold of this wonderful privilege that Father has given to us as heirs and co-inheritors, because that immediately promotes you into leadership. Immediately. 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 When you step into the baptism of the Holy Ghost, you're promoted into leadership, and now you're in authority. You're in authority. As soon as you're in authority, that's leadership. As soon as you received authority, as soon as you received a power, I've given you authority to be sons of God. You're really immediately in leadership right there. I mean, come on, you know. But my, you were endued with power from on high to represent Him. You're in leadership right there. Understand what that means. Understand what you signed up for. And everywhere you see that you're failing, or everywhere that you see that you're coming short, or everywhere you see that you're depending upon the arm of flesh, and that's where you're not getting anywhere. You're working hard, but you're not getting anywhere. It's just the arm of flesh. Cry out to Father. Cry out. Lift up your voice in desperation. He's going to come walking to you on the water. God, the Holy Ghost, is going to show us how. He's going to reveal Jesus. He's going to make this stuff real to us. He's not going to make it real if we're not real. He is the most real person you will ever meet. And He will not do non-real. He will not do fake. He will not do pretend. He will not do anything unless it's absolutely real and true. And He searches the heart. And the beautiful thing of it is He sees where we're not real and where we're just playing pretend and we're doing non-biblical stuff and we're self-justifying rather than being justified by Him. And He doesn't refuse us and He doesn't reject us. He comes to work with us and to help us and to develop us and to show us. And He gets people like me in your face.
Yeah.
A friend of mine got a word of knowledge. He said, I saw a picture of your grandson. And he said, as soon as I saw the picture, he said, I saw your face. And in this dear brother, he flows in an amazing word of knowledge. He said, you know, this comes. I'm not asking for it. When it comes, you're not asking for it. It just comes. He said, I saw an authority on him that was like you, but greater. And he's the guy who told me that when I preach, my eyes change colors. He said, the name Spitzbergen is synonymous with the awakenings of God.
Amen.
And I see something so great in your grandson. Well, listen, you know what? I claim that for my family.
Yeah.
What are you claiming?
Yeah.
I not only claimed it, I lived it. I pressed in for it. I gave myself to the divine principles. I gave myself to the laws of the Spirit. I didn't say that I want it and then just do my own thing and live my own life and be stuck in whatever it is that the rest of the world is stuck in. Doing my, you know, whatever it is that, you know, the crisis was imposing upon me. I said, no, I set my heart on a heavenly vision. I said, wait a minute, what God said in His Word is mine. It's mine. I'm going to do it. It's written there for me to be able to have faith to know that it's mine. And I want you to do that. I'm telling you, I want you to do that.
Yeah.
And I'm just telling you, I like to give reference points to say, look, validated reference points where I'm saying, I've got this person bear witness. I got that person bear witness. This, because listen, this is what God will do for you.
Yeah.
And then not only that, not only are people prophesying, bearing witness to it, but you can see it. You can't look at my family and not say the favor of God's on them.
Right.
You cannot. Yeah. And you know what? I want that. I wanted that more than anything.
Right.
I wasn't just one of many things.
Right.
I wanted it more than anything.
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes.
Can you hear the need?
Yeah.
Can you hear the purpose?
Yeah.
Can you hear the cause?
Yeah.
Can you see the goal?
Yeah.
Do you hear Father calling you saying, I've commissioned you for greatness. This is what you can do. This is your expectation. Look, this is your expectation. You can take 20 loaves and set it before 100 people. That's Old Testament. You can take a few loaves and two small fishes and feed 20,000 people.
Yeah.
And more. This is the expectation of faith. You can say to the wind and the wave, obey me, listen to me.
I was
out when the Cedar Fire came. I was, that thing was coming. It was a wall of fire. It must have been, it must have stretched out 100 miles from where my vantage point was. And it was coming right towards me. And everybody's telling you got to get out of there. And, you know, I realized I had time. I knew where I was at. But nonetheless, I'm out there. You stop right now. You cease right now. I command the wind to change. I command you to die. Every once in a while, I get a wind change. I'm like, yes, in that name of Jesus. Somebody said, well, the fire didn't die. It swept through the place. Yeah, but everything on my property was preserved. People are saying, oh, there goes your house right now. I said, no, that's not my house. Oh, that was your house. I got binoculars. You didn't see my house. All my stuff was fine. I had a big, huge 1,000-gallon diesel tank. And I forgot to take and put the handle that you stick into the gas tank, right?
Yeah.
The nozzle. I forgot to hang the nozzle up high. It was laying down on the ground with a little diesel. Fine. Everything else was like the moon. It burned everything. But my stuff, perfect. No, the fire didn't obey me, but look at the rest of the preservation. Huh? Yeah, but you know what? I'm going to step up. I'll tell you right now, give me another opportunity. I'm going to say right there at the same. Huh? I mean, and I go after it, man. Those little, they call them like, dust devils. I ain't no dust devil coming around me. I mean, I practice the thing enough to where that I say, no! And the thing turns around and goes. I've got my children bear witness of it. No! I'm not getting dusted by you. Just give your share to these things. I just believe this. I've got a president's for it. I'm busy over here in the kingdom. I'm not just living my own life. My life is about the kingdom of God, and I don't have no time for no dust in my eyes. I have no time for no dust around up, throwing all over me. I'm just like, no! But you just give yourself to these things. Be an expectation for them. Come on. From the very beginnings of the new birth and what that's supposed to look like and what that's supposed to result in. To the beautiful glory, the outpouring of Pentecost upon your life. Power to do the works of Jesus. What that's for and what that looks like. Give yourself wholly to them. And if you'll be so given over to what you're supposed to be doing, you won't have a problem with what you're not supposed to be doing. If you'll be looking at all the good things that God has empowered us to be and to do, you won't be involved in all the bad things that He's commanded us not to do. In the name of Jesus, I'm talking to you looking at me right there on your computer. I'm talking to you right now, those of you sitting in those classrooms looking at me on a monitor. in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, you start living the life of Jesus now, today. Listen, get together in your church. Lift up one voice like you're in the boat with the disciples going across the lake. Begin to cry out to God, Father, make us fruitful. Lord, give us a divine strategy to be able to reach the lost, to see a growth come to your church and to your house. And I promise you, He's going to come. In a supernatural display of His divine power and glory, take you to a whole nother dimension of revelation and faith. And I say that to you as well, obviously I'm saying it to you. And I pray that you remember what we pled with you with on Wednesday night by the Spirit of the Lord. And that you recognize your response to what we're saying is your response to God. Because that's the way He's set the program up. To begin to pray and cry out to God with us for divine strategy, how He wants us to do it. And I promise you, all you got to do is start praying and the Holy Ghost will bring these things to your remembrance. If you didn't pray, if you didn't start praying, He had no opportunity to bring the things into your remembrance. Do you see the participation? And then the impact. When you begin to participate, when you begin to obey God, He'll do the supernatural. But if you don't participate, if you don't engage, if you got, well, I had to do this and I had to do that and I used that normally, but then I didn't. Nonsense. Huh? Come on, man. Come on. In Jesus' name. Listen, hear me. Hear me. This is what the Lord says. Be wholly given to this glorious thing. Be wholly consecrated to this amazing grace and divine privilege that we've been given. And Father will fully reveal it in your life. He will do it. He will cause it to happen. He will perform it. No longer let doubt and unbelief rule you. No longer let the arm of flesh be your idol and your God. No longer let human expression tell you what you look like, what you act like, what you think, how you behave, how things are going to be in the future. That's a non-biblical existence. Let the Word of God describe to you your every move. What today's going to look like. What tomorrow's going to look like. What you're going to be. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the name of the Lord Jesus. Amen. Well, if you're not healed, you ought to be. If you're not strengthened, you should be. In the name of Jesus Christ, you function from this day forward in the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the things that's been given to you. And understand, in the spirit of wisdom and revelation, God comes with gentle nudges that are easily disobeyed. It would be being wholly given over to the Lord and consecrated to Him, that nudge is going to turn into your obedience and submission to the nudge. And before long, it would be more than a nudge. God, the Holy Ghost, will move you. Because you would have given Him permission to the point where it's almost like He woos you. He's telling you what to do because it's no longer a question of your will. Is Mark going to agree with me? Is he going to move with me? Is he going to obey me? Is he going to yield to me? Is he going to choose my way? All of that question is answered every time by my reaction to obey Him, to move with Him. And I promise you, the more you just give yourself over to just obeying God, just simply yielding to Him, my. The more glorious it gets. I mean, it's just heaven. That's a transition from heaven. I hope I made it so easy to you. I hope you can understand how to practice being translated. I hope you can understand how to give yourself over into growth and maturity, because it's so practical, it's so simple, it's all based upon this intimacy of relationship and obeying the Lord. Everybody stand with me. Hallelujah. Listen, tonight, in closing, I just want to say this. If you're not busy doing something in the ministry, you need to get busy. If you have any skill set whatsoever in the Bible, in Scripture, in the Word of God, and you're not doing something right now in the ministry, not somewhere else, then you need to talk with me, because you know what we're doing in the age group of 13 to 17, we need more help. We need more people participating in that. And you know, I want to begin to start moving some people around, some people that have been, you know, effective and focused on children's ministry. I want to move you into the youth ministry. And you know, we're talking about some major changes that are going to go on in the way those Thursday night meetings take place. And so I want you to let me know. You email me, text me, grab me, and talk to me about it. We want to get you involved, get you into a place, because that's where you actually step into a place of being trained to be a leader. And and that's where you begin to engage that much more into cooperating with the Holy Ghost, because that's what this is all about. That's what this authority is all about that's been given to us, to be able to be effective in reaching the lost, teaching them to observe all that He's commanded them. So equipping them with the authority that He Himself displayed for us, that we can send them to. But listen, you have to recognize that's what makes you the difference between someone who's still deciding to be a follower and a follower, or a follower and someone who's being trained to be in leadership. If you yourself have not been being developed into being sent, then how can you ever participate with developing someone else into being sent? So now you've got to deal with your non-biblical existence. And I want you to. I don't want to leave you in darkness. I don't want to leave you in doubt. I just want you to get over here into this place. Give yourself wholly to God in Jesus' mighty name. Give yourself to a biblical definition. This is what we're going to do. This is what we're going to do it like Father described it. We're going to live the life like as a person who just stepped out the pages of the Bible. You get around me, it's like going back to the days of Jesus. Amen. Yes. And that's what it says about that. That's what they need to be saying about you. Everywhere you go, every one of you ought to be known in your communities as the Bible scholars, as a person that looked like you just stepped right out of the pages of the Bible. Every one of you, every one of you, because that's who you are. That's what you're saying. That's what you're doing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, it's joy unspeakable, isn't it? Just let the Spirit of the Lord, if you don't know how to yield to joy, let the Spirit of the Lord show you right now so that you can just yield to the joy. Just, you know, it's going to put a radiant smile on your face. And you want to be quick to be able to do that. And just as quick to be able to also yield to love. And just immediately just, so I want you to go find a bunch of people and hug them right now and tell them that you love them, bless them in the name of Jesus. Thanks for coming to the School of the Spirit. Ha, ha, ha.